Take your candle, go light your world. There was families represented there and ministries represented there, and it's by the grace of God that we can light our world. Well, I come to you this morning following 3 weeks of emphasis on passing on the truth of an awesome God to succeeding generations and of equipping upcoming generations for their role in a local congregation and finding a place for the young eaglets to return to the nest and make their impact or be equipped to move on to whatever God calls them to. And this morning I'm picking up, 6 weeks a little late, some happenings on Resurrection Day and following. And I hope that this can be of a help in inspiring us as we move on and continue our ministry here at Fairview. If you have your Bibles with you, I invite you to turn with me to John 20, and I'm reading from verse 19 through verse 31. When therefore it was evening on that day, the first day of the week, and when the doors were shut, where the disciples were for fear of the Jews, Jesus came and stood in their midst and said to them, "Peace be with you." And when he had said this, he showed them both his hands and his side. The disciples therefore rejoiced when they saw the Lord. And Jesus therefore said to them again, "Peace be with you. As the Father has sent me, so also I send you." And when he had said this, he breathed on them and he said, "Receive the Holy Spirit. And if you forgive the sins of any, their sins have been forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they have been retained." But Jesus, one of the 12, called Didymus, was not with them when Jesus came. The other disciples, therefore, were saying to him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said to them, "Unless I see in his hands the imprint of the nails, and put my finger into the place of the nails, and put my hand into his side, I will not believe." And after 8 days again, his disciples were inside, and Thomas with them. And Jesus came, the doors having been shut, and he stood in their midst and said, "Peace be with you." And then he said to Thomas, "Reach here your fingers and see my hands, and reach here your hand and put it into my side, and be not unbelieving, but believing." Thomas answered and said to him, "My Lord and my God." And Jesus said to him, "Because you have seen me, have you believed? Blessed are those that did not see me and yet believed." And many other signs, therefore, Jesus also performed in the presence of his disciples, which are not written in this book. But these have been written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life in his name. Father, I pray that you'll take my words and the truth out of this passage of Scripture, and that you will minister to our hearts and encourage us to continue to take our candle and light our world. In Jesus' name, amen. Here in this passage, we have various incidents, and we're beginning to notice three results of his risen presence. And let's notice the first incident along with the first result. Number one, it was fear that was turned into ministry. John 20, verse 19, it was Resurrection Day and Easter Sunday evening following the empty tomb incident. And the disciples gathered behind closed doors. And it says there, for fear of the Jews. Now, everything was not clear to them yet, and they are certain that sooner or later, these enemies of Jesus are going to come and seek them out as well. Jesus had told them that they would know the hatred of the world as he had experienced it. In passages such as John 15, 11, we find there, or John 15, 18, if the world hates you, you know that it has hated me before. And in 16:2, they will make you outcast from the synagogue, but an hour is coming for everyone who kills you to think he is offering God a service. And then even over in his great priestly prayer, high priestly prayer, in John 17, verse 14, he says, Lord God, I have given them thy word, and the world has hated them because they are not of the world, even as I am not of the world. And so they were thinking as they were there behind closed doors, it's coming sooner or later. So they were meeting in fear, listening fearfully for every step on the stair and for every knock on the door, lest the representatives of the Sanhedrin should come and arrest them too. You know, when you're at home, there are some times when a noise at night wakes you up. And you kind of listen attentively because you're not sure what it was. Makes me recall an incident we had when 12 of us went on an MCC learning tour in Nicaragua and Guatemala. And we were at the Semilla, which is the Anabaptist Mennonite seminary down there where we were staying. We were staying at their guest house. And the layout of the house was the main part of the house was the living room, kitchen, and that kind of thing. And then there was a door, and inside that door is where our guest room was, and we were staying there. And they also had a watchdog, and he was out in the main area of the house. Well, just before we got there, there were two robberies within the 2 months prior to our coming. And the phone was tapped so that you couldn't say much when you did call out if you did use the phone. And when we came home that evening, there were two guys looking around the house, and they quickly moved away when they saw us coming. And then we went to bed. And soon after we went to bed, there was a gunshot, or there were firecrackers, whichever, right outside of our window. And we smelled gunpowder. We were a fearful crew of MCC representatives that night, gathering behind closed doors and drawn blinds, waiting and listening for the enemy. We didn't know what was happening out there. And the watchdog was whining even to get into our part of the house. So we were a fearful bunch. And believe me, if Jesus would have appeared in our midst and said, "Peace be to you," we would have rejoiced as well. So it was with the disciples. All of a sudden, in the midst of that fearful band of disciples, the risen Christ was present, just like that. No knock on the door, no feet on the stairs, no warning that he was going to appear in such a way. Peace be with you. Can you imagine their startled surprise? And in verse 20, it said, he showed them his hands and his side. He wanted them to be sure to understand. He wanted them to be sure that he was not just a mystical apparition or vision that they were having. Here in their midst stood Jesus, the risen presence the risen Christ. He was standing in their midst, one who had walked with them for 3 years, one who had been suffered for them. He had been nailed to a cross, and his side had been pierced, and he wanted them to understand that this was really him. Make no mistake about it. You are in the presence of his risen presence. Hallelujah. The disciples, seeing the master with their own eyes, were exuberant, the message says. They rejoiced. They were glad. And then Jesus said something to them that they dare not forget. And as time went on, it probably became more etched in their minds more and more. Verse 21, peace be with you, but just as the Father has sent me, so also I send you. As God had sent him forth, he is sending his disciples forth. And Westcott calls this the charter of the church. And it means a couple of things. It means, first of all, that Jesus Christ needs the church. Jesus had come with a message for all people. Now he was going back to his Father. Unless the church took it, the church was to be that message could never be taken out to all people unless the church took it. The church was to be a mouth to speak for Jesus, feet to run his errands, hand to do his work. And therefore, the first thing that this means is that Jesus is dependent upon the church. How does that make you feel? He is dependent upon his people that are empowered by the Spirit. And the back of the bulletin, another bulletin, you've heard of the legend that said when Jesus returned to heaven and was confronted by Gabriel, who wanted to know if all the people on earth knew what Jesus had done for them, Jesus replied, and so, no, he said, not everybody. There's only a handful of people that knew the story. And so Gabriel asked Jesus, he said, well, what have you done that everyone would hear about his love for them? And Jesus said, I'm expecting Peter and John and the rest of them and Mary and Martha, all those who knew of his story, to tell others. Those who believed would then tell others until all humankind would hear about what he had done. And Gabriel was skeptical and wondered if Jesus had made other plans should this one fail. Jesus simply replied, there is no plan B. It's dependent upon my followers. And so, as we go on, Peter and John did their work, and we are called to do our work as well in this day and age. But secondly, the charter of the church means that the church needs Jesus. A person who is to be sent out needs someone to send them. He needs a message to take. He needs a power and an authority to back his message. He needs someone to whom he may turn when he is in doubt and in difficulty. So then this means that not only is Jesus dependent on the church, but the church is dependent on Jesus. But there's another thing. The sending out of the church by Jesus is parallel to the sending out of Jesus by God. But no one can read the story of the fourth gospel without seeing that the relationship between Jesus and God was continually dependent on Jesus' response to his Father. They connected closely, Jesus and his Father. We must connect closely with Christ. And so, in verse 22, he goes on to say, he breathed on them and said to them, receive the Spirit. So they are not going to be left to themselves. They are going to function on his direction and his authority and his energy. And so it is with us as well. As we receive the Spirit, we're not simply left to our own devices and strength. There is the direction, authority, and energy of another to draw upon. We often think of drawing a diagram of the church and the leadership, and we put the leadership at the top, and then the pastor at the top, and then the church is down here, and all that kind of thing. And I think maybe a better way to visualize this is to turn this on its side and the pastor is over here speaking into the people truth of God's word. And the people are hearing directly from the Spirit himself, or from God himself. Because the veil was split in two, and we have to enter into the Holy of Holies ourselves. We don't have to have a representative. And so when the pastor speaks to us, we are trying to hear from God through the words that he says. And as God inspires us and fills us full and empowers us with his Spirit, we have his risen Spirit to move us into ministry. It's moving us from fear to ministry, from cowering in a locked room to moving out and declaring that Jesus is the Messiah. He is the Lord. He is the Savior of the world. But how often does the contemporary church find itself behind closed doors? Fearful and ineffective, living on the wrong side of the resurrection. The problems are so vast and the enemy so overwhelming, and all the talk about Jesus seems futile. What can be done but hide in the sanctuary discussing how desperate the situation is? And don't we do that sometimes? We discuss how desperate the situation is, how much is wrong with the world. But there is a movement into the world that we need to take. We are to light our candle and move into the world. So we ask this morning, I ask myself, what fears hinder me from moving out behind closed doors? What fears hinder you from moving out? Do you have your safe places that you can retreat into? Or can you move out and face whatever is out there before you? For the disciples, Jesus comes, shows them his wounds, and he has received, and says, I have sent you, and as I have been sent, I am sending you. And those two, his disciples, will experience the wounds that come to him. He breathes on them, receive the Spirit, and then they are authorized to carry forward his ministry of forgiveness, to continue Jesus' priestly work. Notice verse 23. It's an interesting verse. If you forgive the sins of any, their sins have been forgiven them. If you retain the sins of any, they have been retained. When someone comes to you and asks for forgiveness, what do you say to them? Do we speak the words to them, you are forgiven? Only Jesus has the power to forgive sin. But we are representatives, and we have the distinct privilege of speaking to people and saying, your sins are forgiven. You are released. You are free to enter into ministry. God has forgiven you. He has made the sacrifice, and you are free to do your ministry. I recall that song of Peter, the Easter song, Peter. He's alive and I'm forgiven. Heaven's gates are open wide. Peter was so joyful there that Jesus was risen again, because he was wondering what in the world would he ever say if he saw Jesus again when he had denied him three times. And he was so happy that Jesus had risen again. I'm forgiven, and heaven's gates are open wide. Well, let's move on to the second result of his risen presence. And this one is that doubt is turned into confession. Verse 24, but Thomas, one of the 12, was not with them when Jesus came. Oh, dear. Thomas was missing, and he didn't get to see Jesus in their midst. And to Thomas, the cross was only what he had expected. When Jesus had proposed going to Bethany, when the news of the illness of Lazarus had come, Thomas's reaction had been, well, let us go also up with him that we may die with him. Thomas never lacked courage, but Thomas was the natural pessimist. And if you go back to the 11th chapter of John and read what Jesus had heard, that Lazarus was sick, and he waited two more days, and then he heard that he was died. And so he said, now let's go up. And the disciples questioned him and said, you're going to go up there when they were trying to kill you? You're going to go up there again? And so Thomas said, okay, let's go on up with him and die with him as well. Thomas was a person, was a pessimist. There can never be any doubt that Thomas loved Jesus. He loved him enough to go to Jerusalem to die with him when the other disciples had been hesitant and afraid. What Thomas had expected had happened, and when it came, for all that he had expected it, Thomas was heartbroken. So heartbroken was he that he wanted to be alone with his grief. And we do that many times. We become alone with our grief. We separate ourselves from the fellowship sometimes when we think we have done something wrong or we have a lot of grief. And there is time for personal grief when we share just with ourselves and have to work through our grief. But we need to not withdraw from the fellowship, because when Thomas was not there, he did not see the Christ when he came. And sometimes in our midst, as we work with people and as we fellowship with people, the presence of the risen Christ comes to us and it ministers to us. And it removes things from us that no other thing will do when we fellowship with others who are the people of God. So, furthermore, Thomas was a seeing is believing person. Verse 25. The other disciples therefore were saying to him, "We have seen the Lord." But he said, "Unless I see in his hands the imprint of the nails, and put my finger into the place of the nails, and put my hand into his side, I am not going to believe. I will not believe." The news that Jesus had come back seemed to him far too good to be true, and he refused to believe it. And we call him Doubting Thomas because he wanted to make sure about his resurrection thing before he threw his hat into the ring. He had not yet seen or witnessed the risen Christ. And here's a bit of humor for the fishermen. They might like it or they might not. But in the Wisconsin Fishing Guide, it says, "The only thing that casts doubt on the miracles of Jesus is that they were all witnessed by fishermen." Maybe Thomas wasn't so sure about the witness of these fishermen either. Anyway, so another week elapsed, and Jesus came back again, and this time Thomas was there. And Jesus knew Thomas's heart. He repeated Thomas's own words, and he invited Thomas to make the test that he had demanded. And Thomas's heart ran out in love and devotion, and all he could get out of his mouth was, "My Lord and my God." When he saw, he believed, "My Lord and my God." Jesus offered Thomas his risen presence, and you can see the doubt turn into confession and conviction. It doesn't take Thomas long to be convinced. The expression on his face, the joy in his heart as he saw Jesus again, he was so awed he could hardly talk. "My Lord and my God" was all he could get out at that moment. His honest doubt had been rewarded, and he turned quickly into a confession of Jesus as Lord. But as one commentator pointed out about Thomas, Thomas had two great virtues. Thomas absolutely refused to say that he believed when he did not believe. Thomas would never say that he understood what he did not understand, or that he believed what he did not believe. There is an uncompromising honesty about Thomas. Thomas would never still his doubts by pretending they did not exist. And then furthermore, Thomas's other great virtue was that when he was sure, he went the whole way. "I'm all in. My God, my Lord and my God," said Thomas. There was no halfway house with Thomas. Thomas was not airing his doubts just for the sake of mental acrobats. When he did become sure, his surrender to certainty was complete. And then down in verse 29, this is us. Verse 29, Jesus said to him, "Because you have seen me, have you believed? Blessed are they who did not see me and yet have believed." That's us. You know, has Jesus walked into your house and asked you to put your fingers in his nail prints? No.
We have believed because the truth has come to us from Scripture. It has been passed on down to us. We're trying to pass it on to future generations. We believe because Jesus is risen. And there has been testimony to that fact time and time again. And people have shared that with the younger generation. And so we are working at that as well.
So his risen presence turns doubt into confession and conviction. But yet we need to notice thirdly that his risen presence turns signs into life. Not signs along the road, but signs, attesting miracles, incidents. Here in John, there was recorded water into wine, woman at the well, 5,000 fed, the bread and the fish, the blind man healed, Lazarus raised in anticipation of his own resurrection. And it says in verse 30 and 31, many other signs, therefore, Jesus also performed in the presence of disciples, which are not written in this book. But these have been written that you may believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, and that believing you may have life is in his name. If you're questioning, go back and read the book of John. If there's any truth in it at all, it just shares the message of Jesus from start to finish. This past Tuesday, we were privileged to take a new person drive for Love Inc. And this person, Chuck, we took him over to Traverse City for his oral surgeon appointment. And his wife went with us because she has Alzheimer's and she doesn't talk much, and so she can't be left alone, and so he took her with him. And as we went, I didn't know much about him other than I know he worked for TBN for a while, the Trinity Broadcasting Network, as an engineer. So when we got in the car and we got out into Luzerne, he was over at Luzerne, we got on the main road, I said, can you tell us a little bit about your background and why you got here? And, I didn't say much until we got to Traverse City. He started talking about his pilgrimage, and he started talking about the signs and wonders that he had had from God. From beginning in his life, he did not believe there was a God. And so he got into UFOs, and he began to explore UFOs and learn about UFOs. And the more he learned about UFOs, the more he could not sleep. He became fearful, and he couldn't get a night's rest, and he didn't know what to do. And a pastor invited him to his home one time, and he said, I feel such love here. I feel such love and feel safe here. He'd go back to bed and have a terrible night. And finally, he was led to Christ, and he saw Christ. And he came to Christ, and his sleep began to be restful. And he talked about those signs, and he talked about other signs that he was attesting to. And he talked about one, he said,